While connected technology is essential for unlocking new efficiencies on the production floor, it's also presented hackers with new opportunities to steal valuable IP and data. To support OT professionals in their battle with cyber criminals, we launched the Security Breach Podcast. In each of our over 100 episodes, we've brought in cybersecurity specialists to provide valuable insights and break down critical topics. As a go-to podcast for our listeners, we want to help you align your brand with our expertise. By sponsoring our podcast, your brand will build trust, and your message will stand out to an audience searching for tools to assist their cybersecurity efforts. Secure your share in this rapidly growing segment by sponsoring Security Breach. Contact us today to learn more. Hi, I'm Jeff Ranke, Editorial Director of Manufacturing.net and Manufacturing Business Technology. Welcome to Security Breach. Next to artificial intelligence, one of the biggest buzz terms in industrial cybersecurity right now might be SBOM, or, you know, that software bill of materials. The term generates equal parts concern and eye roll as those entrusted with enterprise defense look to ensure that there are no embedded vulnerabilities amongst the data platforms they're both sourcing and utilizing within their offerings. Perhaps most frustrating is having to essentially reverse engineer a number of established products in order to quell these security concerns. However, as frustrating as these efforts might be, the growing number of zero-day hacks emanating from embedded security vulnerabilities will only continue to grow as we look to embed greater levels of sensor, software, and AI-driven functionality. Here to walk us through this new collection of challenges is Marcellus Buchheit. He serves as the president and CEO of Wibu-Systems USA and is the company's co-founder. Wibu-Systems is a leading provider of security solutions for embedded data and intellectual property. Marcellus, thanks so much for joining us today and welcome to Security Breach. Talking about the embedded security that's being more prevalent in more and more products, it's becoming more of a concern with manufacturers, especially in generating that SBOM list. Maybe you can just give us an overview from your perspective and working with this on a day-to-day basis. Where are we in terms of quelling some of these concerns or addressing other people's worries about generating more information about some of this embedded security?
Yeah, so security in IT, I would say it is solved, but it's well addressed and it is well known. And it's a long path, actually, 30 years. I remember Windows 95. Was a system which was not really ready for internet, but it was open to the internet, and then all the security breaches came. And we today in a very similar situation in embedded. I would not say it's the same danger. People are more aware about the situation, but a lot of embedded systems are relatively old. So in embedded environments, devices will not be replaced in the same frequency like in IT. Yeah, when you have a laptop which is 5 years old, everyone is saying, hey, time for a new laptop. When you have a device that runs since 5 years, you're really happy. They're hoping it runs for the next 10 years. Yeah. So the average replacement of a device in the OT world, so the operational technology, is 22 years, and in IT, 3 years. And that shows just the challenge. People, it is not a cost factor alone. It's a factor like you have a running system. You not change things on that, and you say, why should update it for security? Or you have the situation that you get the certification that your safety is in shape, and any changes even brings more security in, needs a reconfiguration of this certification, which is expensive. So people have good reasons not go with the latest security. However, whenever you bring such a system to the internet, and it is not just the internet, it's you bring it in a connected world, whatever that means, you have a risk that hackers find relatively quickly the weakest part of this connected world, and this could be this one device, and then from there they can start either an attack through this device or using this device to start another attack. And we can only solve that problem if every device manufacturer is aware of a situation. He uses the latest hardware. It starts with up-to-date hardware. It goes to up-to-date operating system. It goes to latest awareness what secure programming, secure design in their component means. And then it goes to an operator, or I guess to, I would say before it goes to an installer who is aware what security means in connected world. And then from there it goes to an operator who said, okay, I'm a know that security permanently expires, it getting old, I have to update that. Yeah? And so it's a widespread of responsible heads to have a secure system in the embedded world. It's not, and it's the same challenge like in the IT world. In the IT world, we just more aware that things are dynamic. You switch on your computer in the morning and Microsoft says, hey, I just updated your Windows. If you don't want this or not, it's updated. You see suddenly a bug in Word and say, well, that was not happened. Oh, I get a new Word update overnight. Okay. And this is a normal thing. While and you also aware, I connect my computer in Wi-Fi, I bring my computer from one room to another, I bring my computer in the airplane. So you have your computer is always in a relatively connected world with computer with security threats. And this is totally different from a connected environment in the OT world where everything is very static and not changing things. So the awareness of, yeah, everything has to be updated because everything is expiring and we have to update the software. The security in special is not in everyone's mind.
So what do you think we can do to combat that? Because software upgrades now, it's not just your computer, it's your phone, it's your TV, it's any piece of electronics that you're using. Societally, we're used to these upgrades, these updates. But yet in the OT sector, it's still a stumbling block in terms of taking the time to actually upgrade, which is not just a functionality thing, it's also a security thing now as well. What do you think is getting in the way of us being more diligent about taking that step to upgrade?
Yeah, I mean, the first challenge is a lot of security, a lot of environments in the OT are not connected to the internet. So this is a good thing for security, right? Definitely. And this is in many things not necessary. However, that means the update is not just happened that this device connects the website from the manufacturer saying, oh, here's a new update, I update it. Then you have, of course, the risk while this update process, the device doesn't work, at least in the reboot process. Then you have the risk that there is a small risk, but you cannot rule it out, that after the update, your device doesn't work at all anymore because some side effects prevents the start. Everyone knows this from maybe hopefully not from the TV, but sometimes Windows is suddenly you make an update and something is strange. Yeah, and so in an environment for manufacturing or critical infrastructure or real time provision on energy or something, that's very critical. So you really think, do we need that? And so the whole update process is not established in a way that safety or reliability is easily affected and easily addressed. I would say that's a better word. That means we have the situation on the one side, the update is not as easy as we know it from our TV or from our cell phone or laptop. On the other side, because we need, in the worst case, walk around with a memory stick with the latest firmware. And this is not an old device, it's the same firmware. Every device is different. Any device is from a different company. So you need maybe an server where all the new versions are stored and you make it from there. It is in nearly always a manual process. So people walk from device to device. So it's quite annoying. So people try to block it and say, okay, we just not go to the internet, which is, in many reasons, a good start. The challenge starts when you have this OT environment, which is considered unsafe, connected to your IT department, for example. You won't get real-time information to your ERP system and say, we want to know what we sold on any energy today. We want to know how everything runs smoothly. We won't get warning in our system. So we bring this information from the OT to the IT world, and suddenly now you are connected to an IT world which is itself considered safe, but your OT world is not. And that is a critical thing where there is methods to solve that, but this is something where I would say, first warning, don't connect your OT to your IT without thinking what you're doing.
Absolutely. So we know all those challenges exist. And another one, and you alluded to it in a number of fronts there, is downtime in manufacturing. It's such a big concern. And sometimes these updates are, the reluctance to update is part of that dynamic as well. How do we get past that? Whether it's updates from a software perspective, whether it's patching against vulnerabilities, how do we deal with some of those downtime concerns and still meet the security requirements that we need to now?
Yeah, I think we need standards to define how our update process works. So our update should be a normal thing. It should be run automatic. So at least in assembly lines, you have a downtime where you replace your oil, you replace your gaskets, you have a physical downtime of maintenance. And in this time, you could say, now we press a button somewhere and all the robots and all the devices, the sensors, everything are updated. Yeah? And when that would be working, because the devices support that, that would be help. So you could say, the device is automatically checking, centralized. Is an update available for me? Wherever that's coming from, a dedicated server or from the internet, that depends on the specific environment. But then you want it also in a standardized format. Yeah? So how we communicate today in Ethernet, where we have a standardized format, how we exchange bytes, and we have a more sophisticated security mechanisms like on design methods and other stuff, we need similar methods for updating. So we say updates need standardized. And the good news is we're running more and more in standardized platforms. We're using Linux or similar things, which have already an established process of updating. So all what we need is that your device is adding that, and that's missing. So back to my other topic. So we have this onboarding where we say, for example, I connect the device to a network, and everyone understand what this device is doing. Can I trust this device? Can I communicate with this device? So this is an oncoming standard, and that's very good. Yeah. For the operator sees, I can trust this connected device. It's not someone bring a virus in or something with that, or it's just a dangerous device. We need a similar mechanism for updates.
We'll be back after a quick break.
AI is changing the game of business. Will you be on the winning team? I'm Jordan Wilson, the host of the Everyday AI podcast and your coach to help you learn the X's and O's of AI. Artificial intelligence isn't just a new player in the game, it's a new sport altogether. So if you don't quickly put AI into play, your competitors will run up the score. I've spent my whole life building winning teams, from coaching basketball to working with big players like Nike and Jordan Brand. My next move? Helping you win with Everyday AI. Listen wherever you get your podcasts or on everydayaipodcast.com. Let's tap into AI together and put points on the board.
So where does the onus lie in creating that type of system? Is it the user? Is it the software supplier? Where is it, a combination of both? Or where do we need to start, I guess, in getting that going?
Yeah, I mean, it's a good question. It comes usually, I think it has to come from the device manufacturers, because they get forced by their customers who said, we need a solution for that. Yeah. And I mean, this is one solution of many, this update. Yeah? Yeah. This is just a point we just come to that with this talk. Yeah, this is not the only one. In general, device manufacturers should not reinvent the wheel. They should say we build on established standards. We just implement our own functionality. In the past, it was also sometimes difficult because your device had not enough power. The CPU was very limited. The memory was limited. You have practically maybe your own firmware running, your own operating system. Communication with HTTPS was, for example, too expensive. So your password would transfer in clear text with HTTP. So all these things are mostly gone because hardware today is relatively inexpensive with a high performance on from the processor, from the memory. It started very simple. People expect videos today on a device. I wouldn't say they expect it, but this is nice to have. You have a touch screen, you have some questions, you don't know how you use it, and you press your little video and you see how your device works. That just shows when a device is powerful enough to have a touch pad with a video capability, it should also be powerful enough to implement the latest security standards. So this is, I think, a game changer. So companies have to say, okay, we go to inexpensive standardized hardware with enough performance to fulfill also the security in future, not just today.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, another area that you guys work in extensively on a regular basis is protecting intellectual property. For manufacturers, next to their employees, it's probably their number one asset, especially when you get into food and beverage, chemicals, other areas like that. What do you think is, or what's your take right now in terms of how companies are protecting that intellectual property, or what are some things they're missing right from the start and making sure that it is secure?
Yeah, so intellectual properties, this, of course, we just say it could be a video, how you use a software, how you use a device. It could be more sophisticated. That is one point. The real critical point, what you probably more talk about, is computer programs, code which is running. And there is a lot of bad people that just try to imitate this code. A lot of this code is translatable, so you have it in different languages available. Your languages are separated from the code, sometimes in a separated file, sometimes in separated blocks in your executable. So it's relatively easy for a sophisticated hacker to replace this text and just say, now it's our program. And when you have this in China running or in Russia, it's nearly impossible to go with lawyers behind that because it will be very expensive. And when you solve the problem and come with a new version, it started over. Yeah. So it's not really. So the only way to come out of that is that this code is sealed against modifications. As this is what we have tools for that. So when someone said, I'm not writing in C++ anymore, I want to write in Java or C#, because we think this is a modern language with less vulnerability from the security aspects, then you have the risk it's a pre-compiled code. It's relatively easy to reverse engineer to modify that. And compile it again and use it as a separate hacked tool. And so we be protecting this MSIL code by encryption. We obfuscate names. We change texts to obfuscated text. So it's for a hacker much more difficult to change this code. So the goal is to say it's more work to crack that, then you rewrite it. Then you're on the safe side. Yeah.
Interesting. You know, whenever we talk about code too, whether it's securing it, writing it, updating it, it eventually at some point leads to a conversation about artificial intelligence and the application of that technology in the right terms. We know the bad guys are using it. The good guys could use it in this application as well. What's your take, I guess, when it comes to OT cybersecurity and the impacts of AI?
Yeah, this is hard to predict right now because, like I said before, OT is more traditional. They're not jumping to the latest technology. But we can expect that the bad guys starting first. So a lot of attacks starting with phishing attacks today. So someone tried to convince to install something that you can do something. And today, most of these phishing attacks by little experienced people, they see this easily and say, I just delete the email. But we can expect with AI, with generative AI, in future, this text will be more sophisticated. They're looking like really a colleague, a friend sent you that, hey, you have to type test this, or you get an email from your boss, instantly do this, it'd be time critical, yeah, and suddenly something is bad is installed and you don't even know about that. Yeah, this is so the chance for using, so the chance that hackers use AI is very high. On the other side, the chance that we can use AI for defense will also growing, but it likely will be slower, which is a bad thing. Two sides should use the same weapons at the same time. But we can expect that AI will be used in future to see suspicious behavior in a network. And when then people say, that is not dangerous, that was just happened because we replaced this device by that device and there's new settings and everything, or we moved something from a physical to a virtual machine or something, then you just say the system, it was okay. And then the system can learn how in this company people work, and can still see, wow, something is now really strange differently, and then you get an alert. So I think these alert systems, who today is sometimes annoying, will be more sophisticated in learning how you're using that specifically in your environment. And that is one thing of many. On the other side, I mean, we will learn from traditional hacking attack patterns. When a new pattern coming in, an AI system can instantly learn this from their own database and said, hey, this is happened now with your system too. So that is why I think we will get a lot of new technology based on AI in around security protection.
Very interesting. And, you know, you mentioned a lot of things going on within the network and within these systems. Specifically with OT, we look at the industrial control system. One of the things that's been, I think, a marked improvement here in the U.S. has been CISA's role in updating users on some of the vulnerabilities that they're finding within these industrial control systems and sending out alerts on them. If you were going to try to categorize what's really going on with a lot of these ICSs and the vulnerabilities that we're finding within them, do they fall under a certain category or a certain type of failure that we're seeing on a repeated basis? And what might be some of the building blocks from a security perspective we can take in responding to them? Because, man, if you try to get at everything all at once, it can kind of feel like you're trying to drink the ocean here a little bit, and people just get discouraged. Yeah. So
I mean, it's finally ends or starts with the operation errors, where people not update their firmware, they update or not update to the way the systems, they not update to more secure passwords and all the things. So when you look so little in the history of famous hacking attacks, it was mostly neglection, you see. It's not that someone really said, wow, that was a real sophisticated attack. We have to learn something new, who never happened before, and now everything changed. No, that actually everyone waits for that. Yeah, this is mostly say, someone, so there is this, I don't want to go into too much details, but when you look a little in history and in Google or something else in famous hacking attacks in critical infrastructure, it was poorly neglectable, neglecting, and it was poorly preventable when people had to do their work. And so that's actually the good thing. But people are under stress, people has no time, people change things and forget things. And so we need, I guess, just more systems who observe that neglectance and warn about. Yeah? But again, then some people shut down the systems because they block something else. And so the security, the mechanisms for that didn't work. So can all happen.
Absolutely. Marcellus, this has been great. And I was hoping maybe you could talk to us a little bit more about your company, Wibu-Systems, some of the things that you guys are doing to help support industrial cybersecurity.
Yeah, so we traditionally have a company who's selling software licensing, and people always ask me, I said, what has software licensing to do with security? Yeah, the first hex to computer software was actually to remove the software licensing. So you had to buy a product. Your friend has a copy of a product, he paid for that. Now you get the copy, you cannot start it in your computer. For example, in the beginning, the floppy disk had a hole somewhere it was assigned to something else. So you learned how you crack that. Yeah. So people started modification of code just to run a license. And so our competitors usually say, I don't care about that. It just happened. Yeah. But we think when someone attacks our licensing system, the customer has the right, we fix that. So we made more and more security blocks around our software licensing, which leads at the end to a highly secure code, which is really difficult to crack and to modify. Okay. And then customers said, wow, can you use this technology also for our code? So when someone licenses our code, he has the ability to protect their own code against reverse engineering and reverse tampering. So any modification of the code, which protects maybe this company from the bad words that someone said, yeah, a famous attack started actually with this program or with this device because their code was very weak. So someone was able to read, for example, an ender password to a database, and that from this database that attack started. Yeah, so like that, this where you at the beginning of all the attack, your device, your name, which is very bad. So we can protect that, and this is really easy. So you have your executable is running, and we have tools to convert that in a licensed and hardened code. You can also check a lot of products are modular, so an executable calls a DLL, or you sell a DLL and other people call this library, and you won't be sure that only authorized customers call this device, and you won't be sure that you only call other code you trust. So there is no hacker code between who've analyzed calls. So we have this ability that if an executable calls a DLL or a DLL is called, with certificates to validate that all this running different modules are consistent and trust each other. So there's also more or less all tool-based. So you have not to develop any code for that. So this is we're doing. And from the licensing aspect, there is also security aspect. Most of our customers using the software licensing to sell specific parts, feature, we say feature on demand, for a different price, or you get a trial version for a test out in a specific module, or you pay something on subscription or whatever. So you have different software features, different licensing variants for different features of your product portfolio. But you could also use this licensing for access control, that you say only specific functions can be used by the controlling, by the licensing, by specific people. And so that is a new aspect for licensing. So licensing for access control, not for selling. That's something we consider more, but the demand on the market is not very high right now for that.
Interesting. Well, great overview of what the company's up to right now. I know another critical area that we're hearing a lot of conversation about is quantum computing and the impact. You know, you mentioned encryption before, how this is going to impact cybersecurity down the road once everybody figures out how to crack some of these codes with a quicker computing time. As we approach this sort of Q day when everybody's getting kind of excited about, what's your perception there in terms of how close we are to that? How much of a priority maybe this needs to be when putting together that cybersecurity plan?
Yeah, so I observed this whole quantum cryptography market about since five, seven years. And it's amazing what happened in this time. So we learn how we use algorithms more effective to crack keys. On the other side, the quantum, then we need a number of qubits. So qubits is practically a single bit who can have several status in a quantum computer. So you can highly parallel different calculations. And you know you need a specific number of bits to do this, and the algorithms reduce this number from year to year. On the other side, you're more able to develop quantum computers with more bits who are working reliable. And you have the challenge still, there is still a lot of distortion. So you need new methods of error corrections and other stuff. So you try on the one side, you reduce the distortion. On the other side, you try to increase the number of error redundancy, of error correction. The challenge here is we not right now here, and I not expect a breakthrough in the next 1 or 2 years, and someone said, "Hop, we have it now." But when it's there, we have a big problem, yeah, because this quantum computer will run somewhere in the cloud, yeah, or this quantum computer will be many, yeah. It's not that you say, "Oh, NSA has one and NIST has one, and when you want to use it, you have to go to there and do something and explain before what you're doing, like a telescope or something." Yeah, no, this is something people said, "I want to rent quantum computing time in Amazon and Microsoft, whatever it is, yeah, and do something." And if you, when you crack keys, you cannot really block that, yeah, because you have maybe good reasons to crack your keys because you lost your own keys, you don't really know, yeah, so. Yeah. Betting on that we can prevent that people use quantum computers to crack keys will not work. And luckily, we have the AES algorithm, which is with 256-bit for symmetric encryption, considered as safe, quantum computing safe, so we don't have to change this. But we have the problem that the elliptic curve and the RSA, which are widely used for asymmetric encryption, where you have a private key and a public key, and have all of this access control infrastructure implemented, they're highly vulnerable from any key length. So there is not any key length you can crack, you can prevent the crack. And when you need it with traditional computers, 10, 34 years to crack a 4,000 ISA, a bit ISA key, you needed 2 years ago with an fictive quantum computer of 4,000 bits about a couple seconds. So it goes really dramatically down. And even with error, even with this distortion issues and everything, you can repeat this calculation operation with this short time a couple of times. And when you have the key, yeah, the quantum computer tell you a key, you have very quickly determined the key is correct or not. If it not, you repeat it. Yeah? So you run finally in environments where you say, okay, all these keys are vulnerable. And that starts with Bitcoin. It goes to a website on your bank. Everything where you think about security today, you have to rethink. So luckily, NIST detected, as NIST, I would say the security science saw this problem very early, so about 10 years ago. And NIST started, like with AES, an initiative to find quantum safe computing. Cryptography, and they're published just the standards right now. So there are five or four new algorithms available who consider this quantum safe. The drawback is they're much more complex in calculation and need much longer keys. So the industry cannot use existing hardware who calculate elliptic curve or ISA in hardware and provide with relatively small firmware overhead, HTTPS security, for example. So we need new hardware, which is in right now under development, because the algorithms are final, the algorithms are verified by the science people. Yeah? So we can expect good algorithms. Yeah? We never know, tomorrow someone is coming and saying, "Sorry, I found a very easy method to crack that," then we have to learn again. Yeah, but in general, it's definitely a quantum jump, yeah, from ISA to this or elliptic curve to these new algorithms.
So it's not going to be just a security concern. It's also going to be a lot of investment as well that comes along with being quantum safe.
Yes, it will be probably a 10, 15 years process where we're learning to use all these new algorithms. That's really not going overnight. It's the same thing like we learned to use HTTPS instead of HTTP. When you think about back in 2000, there were banks. You opt in, they had no HTTPS because they didn't understand the non-necessity, and people with Wi-Fi said, oh, I can read your password. And when you look today, when you go on the HTTP site, you get a warning usually from your browser and say, wow, this is possibly a dangerous website. Don't type in anything. So this is how we learn to accept this new security, and we will have a similar way how we learn quantum safe computing.
So are companies like Google and Microsoft, are they going to be able to provide solutions here as well, or are we going to have to go to a higher level than that?
No, I think the whole industry is aware about the situation. Yeah. So we will, on the lowest level, we have companies like Infineon, this is a partner of us, which will provide quantum safe hardware. So all devices in future can use this. I expect that sooner or later, Raspberry Pi, for example, will support hardware, will do such algorithms. The operating system, of course, so everyone will go in this direction, it is just not overnight, but on the other side, we will not have a quantum computer overnight, at least the current process, but I think we cannot wait 20 years.
Right, yeah, absolutely. Well, it's interesting, you know, we've talked about a couple of big trends that are going on right now in terms of AI and quantum. Is there anything else you're seeing out there, Marcellus, that we should maybe be aware of that could have a big impact here in the short term?
I think the biggest effect is people should be aware about security at all. And they should also be, especially in the embedded world, be secure about safety. So safety and security is not always going along. Some security blocks safety and you cannot do this then, or you have some safety implementations who have to a lack of security because you cannot stop them. So this is stuff which needs well addressed. So bringing the IT security one-to-one in the embedded world doesn't work. You have to understand the challenges additional with reliability and safety and resilience on the embedded world.
You know, one of the things that you've mentioned here over and over again too is a lot of these things are at the lowest level. It's a lot of what I always call blocking and tackling. And a lot of it is because of not so much the technology, but the individuals, the people that are involved. There's always the people factor when it comes to cybersecurity. What have you seen, or have you seen some best practices in getting folks to buy in to a lot of these cybersecurity practices that we need to put in place now?
Yeah, the people factor is always in a danger thing because you have sabotage. You have people that are disappointed with their company. They have a political statement or something or a military statement, and they try to sabotage. That's extremely difficult to block. But the most is neglectance, not aware how dangerous things are and seeing just do daily work and think everything should not change, everything is stable, and then you neglect in the security world change and you not addressed it.
Thanks again, Marcellus. And for more information on the work he and his colleagues are doing, you can check him out at vibu.com. That's WIBU.com. Also like to thank you for joining us today. And to catch up on past episodes, you can go to manufacturing.net, IEN.com, or MBTMag.com. You can also check Security Breach out wherever you get your podcasts, including Apple, Amazon, and Overcast. And if you have a cybersecurity story or topic that you'd like to have us explore on Security Breach, you can reach me at jeff@ien.com. For Marcellus Buchheit, I'm Jeff Ranke, and this is Security Breach.